I would say discouragement and anxieties, because as we speak, as I speak here in New Delhi, in Shaheen Bagh, there are two kinds of protesters now, pro-Shaheen Bagh and anti-Shaheen Bagh protesters. The whole day spent here, I was connected thoroughly on WhatsApp and through Twitter. The YS team was also updating us that how there are a few dozen or maybe a couple of hundred people who are saying that they will forcefully evacuate people who are sitting on the streets in Shaheen Bagh for the last more than 6 weeks. They have spent an entire winter season sitting there under the sky, 6 months old child and more than 80 year old women. So these are very anxious times, I would say, but at the same time, I would say these are also hopeful times. And this is the right crowd, the right audience, and the right speakers in the right place to discuss where exactly are we heading from here. What exactly is going to be the future of dissent in the largest democracy of the world? Do we still have the right to peacefully, democratically protest dissent? I would say the answer is still yes. But the price, there is a price to pay for it. But this time around, not from journalists, not from the usual social elites, this dissent is not just dissent, it's resistance. And we really need to understand this, that there is a fertile ground on which, at the moment where we are facing in the last at least 6 years, and more than that in the last 6-7 months, that one of the most severe attack on India's constitution is there, but there are people who are resisting it. So what do we do of it? So far, in the last 6 years, people like me and millions of others, we were the voice of dissent. So far, what it used to be like between 2014 and 19, that if you say something against the government, you would be anti-national, you would be urban Naxal, people like me would be called a jihadi, they will send you to jail, and all of that happened. Like, for example, if you say something, they would say, this is against Narendra Modi, so this is anti-Modi. By anti-Modi, then the next thing they would say is it's anti-Hindu, then they would say it's anti-India, which means anything you say against Narendra Modi is India. Narendra Modi symbolizes Hinduism, Hindu faith, more than 900 million people, and the nation. But that stage has passed. Now from being anti-India, anti-Hindu, and anti-Modi, there is a clear Goli Maro culture. And it is in your face. I'll give you a small example of what I had to face last week to give you a real sense of what's happening on the ground. I gave a speech in Aligarh Muslim University, and there some students were insisting that they wanted to protest as a Muslim. And I was trying to insist and underline that no, these protests have to be more broad-based and it has to be secular protest. In an ideal society, you should be allowed to bring in whatever slogans, faith, beliefs, and identities you belong to. But since it is not an ideal society, and it's very easy to brand this as an anti-Hindu protest. So